Welcome to Grants Administration Take 10, the how, what, and when of an NIH Grants Administration topic in 10 minutes or less. Today we'll focus on the Forms F grant application form update coming this spring. If you're planning to submit a grant application to NIH in 2020, then selecting the correct form version will be critical to your success. So let's talk about form updates, why we do them, when it's happening, what's changing, and how you can tell one form version from another. Let's start with why we need to update our forms. Form updates allow us to implement new or changing policies, keep current with federal-wide data collection practices, and incorporate usability improvements based on experience and user feedback. You may have noticed that each of our forms has an OMB, or Office of Management and Budget, clearance number and expiration date. The Public Health Services forms managed by NIH are set to expire in March 2020. The Office of Management and Budget must approve our grants administration data collections. Each approval is good for up to 3 years, after which the forms must be reevaluated and reapproved. Although we have OMB approval to continue with our data collection, there is a short implementation period when the new forms aren't yet available for use. You'll continue to use the available form packages, we refer to as Forms E, despite the displayed expiration dates until we can gracefully introduce the new ones. This is okay and expected. Simply follow our guidance and choose the correct form version based on your intended due date. You must use the updated forms we refer to as Forms F for due dates on and after May 25, 2020. That includes all types of applications, new, revision, renewal, and resubmissions, and applications submitted early or late for those due dates. Do not use Forms F for due dates prior to May 25. You must use the current forms, Forms E, for due dates on or before May 24th. Now we'll cover the form changes included in the Forms F update. All of our application forms will be updated to reflect their current expiration date. For many of our forms, the updated expiration date is the only change. However, some of our forms have more substantive changes. Detailed guidance for these and other changes can be found in the Forms F application guide. But let's take a quick look so you know what kinds of changes to expect. A new human fetal tissue section was added to the PHS 398 cover page supplement form. You must answer the question, does the proposed project involve human fetal tissue obtained from elective abortions? And if yes, provide two attachments, the HFT compliance assurance attachment and the HFT sample IRB consent form. These changes allow NIH to accurately identify applications proposing the use of human fetal tissue and help applicants provide the required information. A new description of candidates' contribution to program goals attachment was added to both the career development and the fellowship supplemental forms. Our PHS human subjects in clinical trials information and associated study record forms have the most changes. The main form was reworked to require all applicants to answer the question, does any of the proposed research in the application involve human specimens and/or data? And the explanation attachment is now always available. Previously, the question and attachment were only available when human subjects was no, which didn't allow for scenarios where an application involved both human subjects and human specimens or data. We made a number of changes to the associated study record too. Since study records are only created when human subjects are involved, study record question 14A, does the study involve human participants, now defaults to yes. In study record section 2, study population characteristics, the inclusion of children is now covered in a new inclusion of individuals across the lifespan attachment. And the women, minorities, and children attachment has been relabeled the inclusion of women and minorities. We renamed the enrollment of first subject field to enrollment of first participant to be consistent with the language used in the clinical trial questionnaire, and we added a field number to the inclusion enrollment reports field for usability and instruction clarity. We added a title field in the inclusion enrollment report, and in section 4, protocol synopsis, we removed the brief summary attachment and renamed the narrative study description attachment to detailed description, to reduce overlap in requested information and align with clinicaltrials.gov. And finally, we added the question, is this an applicable clinical trial under the Food and Drug Administration Amendments Act? The PHS assignment request form was reworked to improve usability. Among the changes are clarified instruction text, improved field labels, and a new rationale for assignment suggestions text box. Last of all, the application type field on the SBIR-STTR information form was expanded to include Phase 2C. Though this new application type was requested by another agency, and NIH has no current plans to use it. Now that we know what's changing, let's dig a little deeper into timing. Forms F will be available to work on your applications at least 60 days before the first applicable due date. We plan to complete the posting of Forms F form packages to active opportunities and post the Forms F application guide by March 25. Once the application guide is posted, you'll want to read the Significant Changes section to familiarize yourself with all the Forms F instructional changes. All of our standard submission policies still apply during form transitions. We've indicated May 25 as the first due date requiring Forms F. Well, May 25 happens to be Memorial Day, so applications will be due the next business day, May 26th. We've covered the why, what, and when of Forms F, but how do you distinguish one form version from another? Each funding opportunity announcement has one or more associated form packages that contain all the forms needed to submit. Each package is referenced by a competition ID. It's that competition ID that identifies the version of forms and instructions, Forms E, Forms F, and so on. If more than one package is available when initiating your application, as seen in this assist screen, select the appropriate competition ID for your intended due date. If you use grants.gov Workspace or a system-to-system solution, the screens may look different, but the concept is the same. Notice that the competition title accompanying the ID provides additional guidance for choosing the appropriate application package. Knowing where to find the competition ID and title allows you to verify the version of forms you're working on. They can be found after initiation in the Assist Application Summary tab and in the grants.gov Workspace Details tab. Once your application is submitted and has moved forward to NIH staff for processing, we automatically generate an application summary page and prepend it to your application image in ERA Commons. The competition ID is available on that summary page as well. Some final thoughts. Assist, grants.gov, Workspace, and many system-to-system solutions have copy features that allow you to move common data from one form package to another. These features are especially handy during a form transition since much of the data collection is unchanged. You can get a head start on your application using a Forms E package, move it to the new Forms F package when available, and then make sure you have met all the current requirements prior to submission. Additional notices will be posted as our Forms F plans evolve, so keep an eye on the NIH guide. Subscribe to the NIH Guide listserv to receive weekly posting summaries and to make keeping on top of these and other NIH changes even easier. We know you're busy. Thanks for taking 10 minutes with us to learn about our grant application forms update.